skin from the lovely collects for all saints. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living that we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. This is one of those great SAT vocabulary building colleges. When was the last time you used the word ineffable? Be serious, when you use that word. It's a great word, a terrific little adjective. Joy is so complete and so immense that we simply can't find a way to describe it. By following the saints in virtuous and godly living, we discover we truly love God and are heirs of the kingdom of heaven, and our joy is ineffable. There are a lot of saints, though, to follow, and they may bear some sorting out. They choose a lot of different ways to live out this virtuous life. My own named saint, for example, Elizabeth, Queen of Hungary, she humbled herself in the service of lepers, and she bathed them with her own hands. She encouraged them to convert to a kind of a severe form of Christianity, which she practiced. And if they refused her invitation, she had them beaten. Not so much with the ineffable joy there. But I'm being facetious. And of course, there are a lot of wonderful examples in the community of saints, hearts and minds devoted to following Christ and serving God. They listened to the gospel message and found ways to live faithfully according to Christ's teaching and example. And in case we're in any doubt about how to emulate them, fortunately, we have access to the same instructions they heeded. Last week's gospel, for example, gives us Christ's great summary of the law, all religious law. Love God with all your heart and soul and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And in case we need more specificity about how we are to love God and our neighbor, we have Matthew 25. I was hungry, you fed me, I was naked and you clothed me, and so on. We're to see the face of Christ in every person we encounter, particularly every person with a need we can meet, and we're to serve those persons as we would serve Christ himself. That's what saints do. When we think about our work with our partners in Haiti, that makes a lot of sense. Is a to-do list. Let's face it, we are resourced. We are well-educated. We have way more money than people in developing nations. We've got technology on our side. We go to church and we have a conscience about people in need. We should be able to do a pretty good job of clothing, feeding, visiting, caring for our brothers and sisters who are not so fortunate. But the history of missionary work in the church is not all good. So often we are confident that we know how a problem should be solved without any regard to local context or custom. So often we seek to impose our answers, our political system, our faith. After all, we're following the saints, we're obeying Jesus' own word about giving and serving, so we must be right. But so often our attempts to be helpful do not involve asking the intended recipients what they need or hearing all of the points of view, or acknowledging that our local partners have significant gifts to offer. Parker Palmer says, "Goodness that is driven primarily by the actor's needs is unlikely to be good at all. Such goodness is often imposed on people who have no desire for it, and for those recipients, the experience is not one of benevolence, but of violence. The violence that is done whenever someone decides what you need without consulting you." Numerous visits to Haiti have taught me, among other things, humility. A few very small stories out of hundreds of similar ones about very small encounters. We hike all day to get to a remote school. It's very hot. It's very dusty. We drink all of the water we're carrying. We're still thirsty. A Haitian man opens green coconuts with a machete so that we can enjoy the coconut water inside. "I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink." We're in church, it's very hot. A high school boy traveling with us doesn't feel so good. I take him out to one of the classrooms and tell him to lie down until he feels a little better. I go back out to check on him after time has passed and one of the lay leaders is sitting by him, fanning him with a piece of cardboard he found. "I was sick and you took care of me." hiking down from one of the schools and a tiny hand slips into mine of a little girl who can't be more than about 3 years old. After staying with me for about a mile, gabbling happily and completely unintelligibly all the way, she slips her hand out, waves goodbye, and goes into her house by the side of the trail. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. Who is ministering to whom? All of my ideas about ministry, charity, hospitality, how to be helpful, how to be church, how to follow the examples of the saints, how to be a friend, have been challenged, informed, or deepened by encounters in Haiti with people who see issues from other perspectives, whose faith is strong, whose gratitude to God for what they have in their lives is palpable. Gathering with our Haitian partners and friends, trying to get along in each other's languages, learning to be sensitive about navigating the differences between a culture based almost entirely on relationship and community, and one based on personal independence and accountability. Listening to local experts, wrestling with a seemingly intractable problem, sharing successes and heartbreaking failure, that's when we can really sense the presence of God among us, blessing all of us in our struggles to get it right. You have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship. As we seek to minister to others, they at the same time are seeking to minister to us. They may seem under-resourced, but their faith promises them full citizenship in the kingdom of God, no less than any other brother or sister of Christ. Max Warren, the great General Secretary of the English Church Missionary Society in the mid-20th century, said, "It takes the whole world to know the whole gospel." And Parker Palmer again, "Ultimately, good acts are those that allow people the freedom to choose their own destinies. Good missional partnership requires that we listen, that we step aside from our own egos and wishes, that we respect the dignity of our partners as we accompany them in envisioning a hopeful, achievable future. They may need our help to get there. We certainly need their help to understand better the mind of God. We need each other." Today, we heard that sermon, the Collect for All Saints, and the same collect was said or is being said in French or Creole in the churches in Haiti, too. And Christians are hearing sermons right now about the ineffable joys that await them when they try to get it right. And I would venture to say that many of them are familiar with that feeling already. The collect in Creole and in English. Bonye kigen tout pouvoir à Almighty God. Ugen rode ansan choisi o yoy nanyon sel communion ak di bonye messi. You have knit together in your elect one communion and fellowship. The word was brode, like embroider. You've embroidered together. Nan koa mystique nan petit ou Jésus-Christ. Se no se a. In the mystical body of your Son Jesus Christ, our Lord. Va nous fave pou nous suivre benipep ou anan tout vivant vetye ak vivant. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living. Ou nous carini nan juis ineffable que ou te prepare un qui vremen ou remen ou. That we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Ineffable. Ineffable. Now you speak Creole. You can say ineffable. Dan Jésus-Christ, se nous en through Jesus Christ our Lord. Kimun kiave u ak Saint Esprit aviva ak govonen, who with you and the Holy Spirit live and reigns. Yon selvanye nam tut belgwatutan, one God in glory everlasting. Amen.